Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hi, and welcome to week three. This is the first lecture. This week, we're going to be focusing on the tortuosity associated to rechargeable batteries. Last week, we were talking about equilibrium and equilibrium properties, such as solubility limits and material potentials. Today, we're going to be looking more at the geometry as to when you make a battery, how those particles that you put in the electrodes are organized and how that impacts on the response that you may get. Okay, so we also discussed a couple of weeks back the different contributions to losses that a battery has. And we typically control them by specifying the properties, say, of the back contacts. Say you may have here an aluminum back contact and down here a copper aluminum back contact, as you can see here from the slide, for both the anode and the cathode. Okay, but as just to remind you, as lithium dissociates into a lithium ion and an electron, and the electron is collected here by the back contact, the lithium ion has to diffuse and percolate through this network, including the network that it's really hard to see here, but there's a network of pores associated to the separator. It has to cross that network, then it has to cross all the particles that have already reacted or are competing for a reaction, and then that electron that went through the load and came back here, it has to react with that electron on that side in order to basically insert itself into the cathode material. So today we're going to be talking about that, about how processing impacts on the response of the system, how geometry, for example, here you can see the anode is made out of these platelets where you can see the laths. You can see these very, very large ones down there, okay, and how that impacts on the response of the overall device, okay, and how the ohmic losses that we were quantifying a couple of weeks ago are completely related to the morphology associated to the electrode. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to quantify the conductivity, the total conductivity of that porous composite electrode. And typically what people do to a first approximation is think, well, really the conductivity to a first approximation is a result of the conductivity associated to the particles modulated by the volume fraction of particles I have, which would correspond to this bit over here, okay, plus the conductivity associated to the spaces left between the particles, that is the porosity, which would correspond to this term over here, okay. And if we had perfect layers of anode and electrolyte parallel from each other, it would really depend only on the volume fraction to be able to specify the average conductivity of the system. Okay. In practice, however, there is a geometrical contribution that modifies that. Okay, so that even though if we insist on specifying this rule of mixture type description for the conductivity of the system, we have to determine what that relationship for the conductivity is. And what people have figured out is that this coefficient or function, if you may, the topology associated to the conductivity, really can be related in terms of a quantity that people refer to as tortuosity. So if we have our perfect layers, say a anode and electrolyte, and the material was going in that direction, then the tortuosity would be one, because you would have a perfect path, and you could really describe your material in terms of this rule of mixture. Now, if instead we purposely put these bendy paths, slightly tortuous paths, if you may, then you can raise that tortuosity. Think of it as the length of the path from one side to the other one up to a factor of two. Or if there's no path associated to that, then really the tortuosity becomes infinity. Okay, so that's on that end. So in practice, what will happen is that in a real battery, we never have a structure that looks like the three structures that I just showed you. Instead, what happens is that the diffusion path, the transport path, really corresponds to the linear superposition of all the particles as you compact them and process them and make them interact mechanically with each other when you make the electrode composite. So in this case, you will have different paths. Each path will depend on where the ion starts and how it's diffusing or basically flowing through the electrode, and that completely determines the properties of the system. But one single path doesn't determine. You can think of it as having to consider the statistical superposition of all those paths. Now, if we measure the length of each of these paths and divide it by the thickness of the electrode, that gives us a qualitative measure of the tortuosity of the system, and we'll call that measure the length of the actual path divided by the thickness of the electrode. We'll call that the tortuosity. So if we write the tortuosity in that form, then we can really specify a much more concrete form to that, for that topological measure, and we call that the tortuosity again. And it's really a combination, again, of the conductivity, or the diffusivity, if you may, of the electrolyte and the conductivity of the particles, okay? Now, if we go back and look at what numbers people actually have and use in their battery materials, you will realize that actually the conductivity of the particles is very low, much lower in comparison to the conductivity in the electrolyte. And this is because, well, the whole reason of putting electrolyte in this battery is so that we can increase the average conductivity of the system and to open up spaces so that the material can diffuse through. So really, if you compare this term as compared to the other term, you can really ignore the second term. Okay, so for practical purposes. Now, if you manage to find a material where the conductivity of the electrolyte compares to the conductivity of the particles, then you actually have to account for both terms. But if you don't, if the conductivity of the particles is much lower, if the conductivity of the electrolyte dominates, then you can reduce your relationship to something that looks like this, which is what you will find really in books. Okay, and the trick you can see here is to determine what the tortuosity of the system is, because what people have found empirically is that actually the tortuosity is given as 1 over the porosity to the 1/2. I find this exponent of 1/2 very interesting because, I mean, why is it not 1.55? Why is it not 1.49? It is 1/2. And it was experimentally determined by Brugman in a paper that was published in 1935, where he was using alumina particles also particles of glass. And by doing this, he found that very, very nice relationship that is very easy to remember if you think about it. So why do we care about this then if we compare this relationship to the porosity relationship that now we have with the tortuosity? What we find then is that, well, if we still assume, if we accept that the tortuosity goes as the length of these, the representative length of these paths with respect to the thickness of the electrode, then the tortuosity gives you a measure of the inverse of the ionic conductivity. And what you want is to have these paths to be as straight as possible. So you can think of a very diluted electrode that the tortuosity would be very low, and actually the lowest value that a tortuosity can have would be 1, right? Because we're basically dividing the length of this path by the thickness, and it could not be shorter than the length of the thickness, right? So, and as you start introducing obstacles, those obstacles will increase the length of the path. Increasing with that, then the resistance of the cell, and you know that when we increase the resistance of the cells, as we have discussed in previous lectures, that would lower the energy output and the power of the system. Okay? Now, if we just keep increasing the number of particles, the average length of the system will increase, increasing with that the tortuosity and decreasing the length of the system. So ultimately, you can see how as I keep increasing the density of particles, yes, I will be putting more and more energy that the system will have, but by the same token, the tortuosity of the system will increase, increasing with that further my losses. So we, as you can see from this description, we can have it both ways. We can have a lot of energy in a battery, but we cannot have a lot of power. We can have one or the other one because of these losses. Okay, unless, of course, you find a means to increase further the conductivity of the electrolyte so that those losses won't matter that much, because even if you multiply by a large tortuosity, then they will subtract very little from it. And well, ultimately, this relationship, tau sub b, has been standing, well, basically since 1935, giving you without an idea of the importance and the usefulness that it has been to the battery community to understand batteries and characterize batteries in terms of tortuosity. Now, batteries, when people started to look at them very recently, say in the last 5 or 10 years, they realized that this relationship, which was determined experimentally, only were measured for perfectly spherical under the assumption that particles were perfectly spherical. In practice, however, even if your particles are perfectly spherical, as you can see here in this a computer representation of a porous electrode, you can see that those paths were actually have local bundling of those lines, and as you can see here in this cross section of that 3D representation, and how that bundling could actually impact on the local performance of the cell. Okay, and not only that, because again, these experiments were performed using perfectly monodispersed particles, it became non-trivial to understand what would happen if instead of I have a perfectly monodispersed distribution of particles, that is when all the particles have exactly the same size, what happens if I just start changing the broadness of that distribution so that instead of having them all the same size, I add some little particles, also some big particles, and that broadness, or you prefer the quality of my powder, will degrade so that now I have a very broad distribution of particles, where with respect to the average, you can find these really tiny beads, and at the same time, in the same bag, you can have these giant boulders of particles. Will my relationship for the Bruchman relationship will hold? If you think about it, this becomes very important, because if it doesn't, if it indeed depends on the tortuosity, then what will happen is that I probably want to go to the right vendor and pick one type of particle versus another one. This one obviously will be much cheaper than this one over here, because here I'm acting for much more than what you would usually request, which is I want my particles to be spherical, and I want also my particles to be all of them the exact same size. This will cost 10 to 100 times more than a particle that has a distribution like this. Okay, so experimenters have been performed in the past showing you that when you try to use different types of polydispersities, as you saw in the previous slide, then you will see that that relationship still holds to a first approximation, but if you want it to be very nitpicky, you can actually find some deviations from that. Or if you start going and checking the different types of polydispersity that a battery may deliver, then you will find that at some point, even though to a first approximation, you can still think of having the relationship of 1 over epsilon to the 1/2 to hold. In practice, there will be so much noise associated with that you really cannot trust that relationship anymore. In practice, however, people never go much further than this, and you really can say that to a first approximation, the Bruchman relationship works really well. Now, recent experiments have been published, and what we found, or what you can find, is that again, down here you can see this is the 1 over epsilon to the 1/2, and you can see the simulations, and the analytical relationship works really well. But Thorat and Wheeler published in 2009 a paper showing that for different types of batteries or battery electrodes, here you have lithium iron phosphate, lithium cobalt oxides, you can see different types of materials, and the relationship is not 1 over epsilon to the 1/2, but 1.8 over roughly epsilon to the 1/2. So the 1/2 exponent seems to still hold, but now there's a big shift that it doesn't matter how you simulate this numerically or how you try to justify it. It's just impossible to go from one to the other one. So now the reason for this to happening is because Thorat and Wheeler are very, very clear about this, and they say, as you can see here, the addition of carbon additives, as we were discussing a couple weeks ago, carbon black, graphite, and carbon fibers in cells further distorts the pore structure from the Bruchman ideal. It appears that the Bruchman relation is a limiting case for particulate system, realistic non-monodispersed non-spherical systems will have a greater tortuosity than driven by Brugmann. And they were right. I mean, clearly what's happening is that we are counting in the Brugmann description, we're accounting for the tortuosity induced by the particles of active material. But in a real battery, actually, we should probably take into consideration not only the path, the tortuous path, because of the active particles. We also should account for the path associated to what happens in the electrolyte and graphite mixture. We can actually recover that relationship that Thorat and Wheeler presented by simply saying from here that, well, if we look at this, really the length of that path really corresponds to the tortuosity times the thickness of the electrode. Now, if instead of looking at the background matrix as a uniform phase, we actually look at it as being a mixture of two phases, the carbon black and the electrolyte, you can see that this path actually will be altered, because as compared to before, where we have this very straight line between in this what used to be empty spaces, now we have to account for the additional deviations in this space, which really corresponds to adding additional path in this in across this window. So it's the equivalent of walking down a giant field where you don't have any trees, as compared to the same field with trees in between. In some cases, you're just roughly having a straight walk. And in the other case, if you have a very dense forest, then you have to actually be walking around the different trees. And that adds length to your path, which will in turn translate to increase a local increase in tortuosity. Mathematically, this is very easy to represent, because what you want is to this line, you want to integrate the deviations about that additional line. And mathematically, this is represented by this line integral, where you have, in this case, you're integrating along the tortuous path. That's why this goes from zero to the length of the path. And the deviations and tortuosity with respect to ideal tortuosity of the system, okay, where in this case tau sub nu corresponds to the tortuosity associated to the porous electrolyte. Okay, and if you include that and you do the math, well, you can basically pull out that term, and now you're integrating across the tortuous length from zero to tau naught HC, from zero to that number for the variable DL. And if you do that integral, you will get this expression, which if you then try to simplify, will end up into a new relationship for tortuosity, which in this case corresponds to the tortuosity of the material without the additional, the secondary phase, the microscale porosity, plus the tortuosity contribution from the microporosity alone. So you can think of the underlying porosity of the system as an amplification factor to the total tortuosity of the system. Now, if you take this relationship and include it in the tortuosity of the entire system, then you can see that you can go from the 1 over epsilon to the 1 half, to basically this tau 1 over epsilon nu to the 1 half, where this epsilon times nu contribution really corresponds to the effective tortuosity of the system, because now what you're doing is your tortuosity is not only the empty spaces between the particles of active material, but the space left from the particles of active material and the additional material that is mixed with the electrolyte. So if you include that, then you can see you can have a very nice match, really showing that what we've been discussing about the tortuosity of the system really makes sense to describing that, and how not only you have to care about the losses from the particles themselves, but only what occurs at an even lower length scale in the system. Now, to this point, we have discussed in the context of having perfectly spherical, very well organized particles, and very well mixed particles, and what we're going to be doing on the next lecture, we're going to be talking about deviations from that ideality and try to focus more on more real electrodes and how that impacts on the response of the system. Thank you.